Good morning and good afternoon to everybody. I'm Andrea Mengrini from GEMA Support and Training Team. First of all, I'd want to thank you to have joined this webinar about the satellite systems and new frequencies. This is the second webinar of a list of webinars open to everyone that we are starting since last week. We decided to do this webinars project because most of us are at home due to the COVID, the coronavirus restriction. And we hope we will keep you busy at least for our webinars each week till June. Just to give you an overview from our website, is it possible to go there? Event calendar. And here we have the list of our all webinars that we will do in the next weeks. So you can directly register following this link. So let's start this webinar, this presentation. During this webinar, we will talk about the global constellation and signal. We will see in details how we are using the single basis and the reference station network. We will see how to use the Galileo and Beidou with the reference station network with a focus on our field software, XPAR Ultimate Survey. Constellation signal. We have worldwide four global constellation. The global constellation are the main used for the high accuracy survey. So, but we have also some regional system. The four global constellation are the GPS, the global position system that is an American constellation, the GLONASS navigation system, then we have the new one, so the Beidou, which is the Chinese constellation, and the Galileo, which is the European constellation. Talking about the GPS, 1978 was the first fully in orbit constellation available for civil use worldwide since the 1994. It is currently made up of 32 operative satellites and supplies multi-frequencies like L1, L2, L2C, and L5. The GPS constellation is a mix of old and new satellites. Some old satellites continue to work even if their expected lifespan has already ended. Just for example, the Block 2-8, so the second generation advanced, the Block 2R, the replenishment, the Block 2RM, the replenishment modernized are satellites with the 7.5 years lifespan and were launched between the 1990 and the 2009. Then we have the second block, so Block 2F and GPS 3 and GPS 3F, so the follow-on satellites with a lifespan between 12 and 15 years, and were launched between 2010 till now. The GPS system work on triple frequencies, the L1, L2, L2C, and L5. The L5 is the modernized signal that, respect to L1, LF2, provide better ionosphere connection. So it means that the atmosphere model can be better estimated and reduced. A better signal redundancy. So signal can be stronger and more reliable, especially when we work in a difficult environment, like for example, in case of multipath, and it provides more precise signal. L5 is a frequency already used also on our receivers. In future, all the new satellites will be able to transmit the L5 signal. So if we buy now a receiver which is capable to receive also the L5 signal, can be an advantage also for the future. Then we have the second system, the GLONASS system, operating since the 1983. Should have been the first constellation operating in orbit for worldwide civil use since 1991, but due to some various problems, it entered only in 1995. It is currently composed of 26 satellites and provide multi-frequency signal, L1, L2, L2C and L3. Most of them work only with the L1 and L2 frequencies. Only the new satellites, so at now only two GLONASS satellites use the system K. The system K is capable to transmit the L3 frequencies, and regarding the L3 frequencies, we need to focus on the benefit. So we have a more precise signal. We have also a better interoperability with the GPS and Galileo system. In comparison with the GPS, we have a slightly difference between L1, L2, L3 that are not the same as the GPS, that are the G1, G2, and G3. Also, for these two systems, we have a different satellite height in orbit. The GLONASS system, the GPS system, has a modulation, the CDMA modulation, so code division multiple access modulation. The GPS work only on same frequencies. So when we use the interpolation to calculate the position, if the satellites work on same frequencies, it is easier to estimate also some error. The GLONASS instead has a FDMA modulation, so frequency division multiple access modulation, work only on different frequencies with different modulation. It is also difficult in that case to fully integrate it with the GLONASS and Galileo system. We need to consider also the modernization of the new satellites, so the system K. So in this case, the third frequency, so the L3, use the same modulation as GPS and works with same frequencies as GPS and also Galileo. So use the CDMI modulation. So it means that we have a better integration also with these two systems, so the GPS and Galileo system. The third system is the Beidou, is operating in China since 2005. Thanks to the launch of the first four geostationary satellites. Then in 2012, the number of satellites became 14, of which five stationary satellites, up to 26 that we have now with a global coverage. In reality, we have more than 26 satellites, but only 26 work globally. The Beidou system is equipped with a multi-frequency, so the B1, B2, and B3 frequencies. Then we have the fourth system, the Galileo system, which is the European system operating since 2016. It currently consists of 18 satellites and provide the signal E1, E5A, E5B, and E6. It has been designed to have a perfect integration with the GPS and GLONASS system, with also a robust signal that allows this integration. Then I would like to show you an example of signal quality for the GPS, GLONASS, and Galileo systems. For example, we will talk about the cycle sleeps. What is the cycle sleep? Are the discontinuity in receiver's phase lock on satellite systems signal due to lock signal to noise, for example, due to poor reception due to satellite's geometry, or the presence of obstacle in the path of satellites called multipath effect, or other anomalies. In this graph, we can check the difference occurrence using the GPS GLONASS and Galileo systems. It's a test done by Polytechnic of Turin University during the 2019, so during the last year. In particular, we have on a horizontal axis the year and the days. On the vertical axis, we have the number of bad observation every day. So this means that less value indicates a better quality. It's a logarithmic representation, but we can clearly see that the Galileo performance of signal is better and also more clean. Here we have a second graph that shows how good is the signal that we receive from satellites considering only the absolute position, so the standalone position without any RTK correction. It means with receiver just outside, tracking the satellites, but without any kind of correction provided by network or the single station. We can see the result during a one-day measurement. In particular, on the horizontal axis, we have the hours. On the vertical axis, we have the distances. We have also three lines that refers to the latitude, to the longitude, and to the height. We can see from these three graphs that the GPS and the Galileo are the only two constellations providing good position. In this case, for example, for the GPS, we are in the range of more or less 5 meters. Same for the Galileo, more or less the range is plus minus 5 meters. But using the GLONASS, the range is quite different. So they have more. This is why GPS and Galileo have more robust and also reliable signal. We didn't use Beidou because we have to use a reference station correction, but in this case the data coming from the Polytechnic of Turin University. So the question at the end, the question is, does it make sense to have a full constellation system? The answer, of course, is yes. Here we have a screenshot from our field software, XPAD Ultimate Survey, which shows a real test done with a Zenith 40 receiver that is a full constellation receiver and capable to track triple frequencies. So we use the GPS, the GLONASS and Galileo, not the Beidou because it was not correct on this network. So in that case, we use the Hexagon SmartNet Coarse Network in Italy. And as you can see here, bigger benefit were coming from the Galileo due to this better integration with the GPS system. That's the reason why we are able to receive a millimetric accuracy. The number of Galileo is less than the GLONASS, but it makes a big difference on the accuracy due to this integration with the GPS. The test was done in Europe, but maybe working in Asia, we'll have the same result working with the GPS and Beidou systems. We didn't check it with this value. We already talked about the four global constellations, but we have also some regional constellations. Here we have some example. So we have the NAVIC constellation, so the Navigation Indian constellation that is operating since 2016 in the South Asia, East Africa, and part of the Western Australia. It is composed by 7 satellites and only supplies the L5 signal. Then we have the QZSS, so the Quasi Zenith Satellite System, that is a Japanese constellation operating since 2019 in the Asia Oceania region with a focus on the Japanese region. It's compatible with the GPS, and the goal of this network is to provide a highly and stable positioning services combination with the GPS system. Currently, it consists of 4 satellites with a multi-frequency, so the L1, L2C, L5, and L6 signal. But we have also the SBAS constellation, so the satellite-based augmentation services. Is a geostationary satellites services that corrects only the GPS L1 signal, in some cases also the GLONASS. It is composed regionally, for example, the WAS in US, the SDCM in Russia, the EGNOS in Europe, the EMSAS in Japan, the Gagan in India, and the Beidou in China. Provides an accuracy about 60-70 centimeter without any kind of an example. The EGNOS has been available since 2012 or 2011 and is made up of 3 satellites. Thanks to these services, we can receive an accuracy of more or less 50-60 centimeters without any kind of correction. Relative position and GNSS accuracy. So now we will see how to check the information from the receiver's specification. So what information we have to read about our GPS GNSS receiver. Talking about the topographic receiver means talking about a receiver that can achieve a centimetric accuracy result. First of all, what we need to check is how many frequencies we can track. So, for example, L1, L2 frequencies, if we are also able to track other frequencies. This is an example from our Zenith 40 receiver that is capable to track, for example, for the GPS, all the frequencies, so L1, L2, L2C, and L5, all the GLONASS frequencies, so L1, L2, L2C, and L3, Beidou, Galileo, and QZSS tracking, but also the NAVIC frequencies. Then we need to check also the number of channels. For example, for the Zenith 40, we have 555 channels. So we can consider, for example, the 3 signals, so 3 frequencies, or even if some satellites are only L1, L2 equipped. So, for example, considering 1 satellite means 3 channels. If we divide 555 channels for 3 channels for the 3 frequencies, means that we can track more or less 185 satellites at the same time. So in general, there are more channels that we really need. So receiver that, for example, the Zenith 40 can also track older constellation, the QZSS and the NAVIC, but also the SBAS. And some of them are also capable to use the L-band. The L-band is equipped receivers, so some is a particular correction provided by satellites. We will have also a dedicated webinar on the L-band frequencies and on the PPP solution. GNSS position. Now we can see how to check the accuracy, how to calculate how is calculated the accuracy. So if we talk about the standalone position, so without any kind of network correction, means that we are using in this case only GPS and start to track satellites, more or less the accuracy is between plus minus 5 meters with some errors, so the bias error. So why this plus minus meter? Because during the positioning, so we receive some the accuracy, but we have some positioning error, technical called bias, and the resulting error correspond to the sum of three main bias error type. So the first error type, the first bias error type, it refers to satellite clock. So inside each satellite, inside also each receiver, we have a clock composed also on different materials. Usually the clock inside a satellite is much accurate than the one in the receiver. But since the position is calculating, considering also the time, we have also an error in the position due to the satellite clock. The second type refers to multipath signal error, but also to the phase center offset of the receiver. And the third error, that is the last one, probably the biggest one, is the spatial related error. So depending on ephemerosis, quality, ionosphere, troposphere, so what is the mid in the middle between the satellite and our receiver. The sum of these three errors create the 5 meter error result. So normally we use two receiver just to remove this error, and in particular the error related to the satellite clock and the error related to the spatially error, so the ephemerosis, ionosphere and troposphere error. We have two receivers that usually we call base and rover, that are tracking the same satellite at the same time. So for example, here we have the master references or base and the rover. The reference or base station sent what is called a correction to the rover. The rover is receiving the signal directly from satellite and receiving at the same time correction from a reference station. And with this procedure, we can remove a lot of bias errors, in particular the first and the third error that we are already seen in the previous slide. So the accuracy position will change from plus minus 5 meters, so the accuracy without the correction, up to plus minus 2 centimeters, 1 centimeter. And this is the meaning of relative position. So in this case, we are talking about the single station correction. Since we have error depending also on the distance, also the mitigation of this error depends on how big is the distance between the reference station and our rover. So here we have a graphic showing that more distance we have between the reference station and the rover, and bigger will be the error. So it means that we have a quality gradation of the position accuracy. For example, if we use this configuration, that basically base and rover configuration by radio signal, we know that in general the correction coming from the radio are reliable till 30-35 kilometers. But of course, it depends on the area. Then we need to talk about also the reference station, which used the, for with the network correction. reference station with network correction is what we usually call coarse network or GPS network. It is a system which uses not only the correction from a single station, but uses also the correction from several bases. In this case, means that our rover received the correction not only from one reference station, but also from other reference station closest to the rover. The error in this case will be interpolated between the error that we are receiving from the reference station one or reference station two. So it means that we don't have the red interpolation correction, but the second one, so an interpolation error between two different bases or more bases. So in that case, the error will not depend on the distance between the rover and the single reference station, but the result will be, but the reason why is possible because it is better to work with a reference station network, also because we have a closest reference station that could be a single one, also more than one. Here we have an example of a reference station network provided by Hexagon in Italy, just to give you an example of the coverage of this network. You can go directly on Hexagon SmartNet website in the coverage page, and as you can see here is a global coverage. For example, Italy is completely covered by this network, but it is a worldwide network. We can see together, so we are seeing together the coverage through the link. So if you want also to check it, you can go directly on this website. If we use a rover inside this network, we'll receive the correction by internet and on from the radio signal. So the correction is modeled on the specific region, so we will receive the correction from a particular cell. It means that I will receive the correction not from all the reference station, not from all the reference station, but from the reference station considering my position and the nearest cell. So in this case, the error will be interpolated from the station, and we will have also homogeneous error inside all the regions. Here we have some images that show a coarse network. In particular, we have some antennas placed on top of building, also in a stable, so it represents a stable solution. It seems like the single base, also the single station solution with a radio correction, but in this case, the data are not sent directly by radio, but are not sent directly to the rover. The data in this case are sent to a control center. The control center elaborates all this data and provide also the correction to the rover by the internet connection. So how we can choose the right format to use Galileo and Beidou satellites? Just to continue with the Italian core network from Hexagon, the core network provides the correction using a protocol called NTRIP. This protocol is a standard protocol which requires an authorization with a user and ID password. Usually you will receive this information directly after the subscription. It provides also an IP address and a porter that are simply the internet address from where we will receive the correction, then we have to choose the correct mount point that at the end is the product to use for the correction. So once we are already connected to the GNSS network server, the network provides different type of correction services. So we can understand also the product type directly from the mount point name, for example, type of services and correction format. Here we have an example again from the Hexagon Italian network. So basically, we have three different type of net mount point that we can choose to receive the correction also from the Galileo in Baidu. The nearest means that the network provides automatically the correction from the closest reference station. It is not a real network solution, a real network correction. In this case, more far we are, bigger will be the error. It is similar to a single reference station correction that we already seen before, for example, the SIM, the radio connection. Then we have the VRS, that is the network creates a virtual reference station close to my position. It's created by the network calculating all the station around my position, around my cell, and simulate a reference station closer to my position. So every time I switch on and switch off the receivers, and also every time I come back to the same site days later, month later, it creates new reference station. So a virtual reference station that could be meter distance from the previous one, even if we are working in the same area. So this is not the best solution to choose if you want to continue a work in the same area. Then we have the third solution, the IMAX solution. It's similar to VRS solution. It uses all the reference station closest to my position, but in this case, we will be connected to rover. The rover will be connected to a real station, use also the connection from the reference station. But the correction services depends on the core network we are using. Then we can use Galileo and Baidu satellites only if our network is capable to track the satellite. If I have a multi-constellation rover, multi-constellation receiver, which can be not only rover, but also base and rover with the radio connection, it is important to choose also the correct format. That in this case, is it the RTCM 3.2 or the RTCM MSM format. So the most modern format of RTK data that provides GPS, GLONASS, Baidu, and Galileo correction. If we choose RTCM 2 or RTCM 3, so not the 3.2, it will be only GPS and GLONASS. We'll track them, we'll partially use them, so all satellites, but at the end, the calculation will be done only with GPS and GLONASS. So same also for the Linux format. So if we want to perform a GNSS post-processing, just to have a GNSS accuracy on a second time in our office, we have to be sure that we are using the Linux 3. So just to give you an overview about the RTCM 3.2, it depends directly on the core network we are using. So for example, this core network provides also different kind of mount pointer, RTCM 2, RTCM 3, RTCM 2, 3, and then the list will continue up to the RTCM 3.2 or RTCM MSM. So the RTK correction we have to be sure that we are using the LTCM 2.3 or the MSM correction. Here we have again an example from Hexagon network in Italy, so one more point from the list that we already seen before, that is called the IMAX3 minus MSM. So in that case, we can see that it's transmitting GPS, GLONASS, Galileo, and BeiDou satellites. But of course, as we already seen, it depends on the course network we are using. Here we have also an example of the RINEX3. In particular, we have the G that are the GPS satellites, R that are the GLONASS satellites, E are the Galileo satellites, and C are the BeiDou satellites, which includes also this screenshot includes also the probe observation for all satellites. So if you have any question, you can directly write me on chat, or if you have some comments, suggestion, if you want to ask me something else, you can also write me on the Academy email. So we have some question. I usually have different accuracy in elevation on vertical, or depends it depends also on the area that we are working in. It is possible to update all the receiver for tracking the new constellation. Usually depends on the receiver, also on the band, but usually it is possible. Probably you need an authorization code and also a firmware update, but usually it's possible to do it. We have also another question. Which format I need to use for base rover correction? Again, here is the same format, so the LTCM 3.2 or LTCM MSM. Usually it depends on the core network. We have also a question regarding the PPP. We will focus on the L-band and PPP solution on the next, not the next webinar, but we will have a dedicated webinar also to see in deep the L-band and PPP solution. Okay, we have several questions. What is the difference between the different formats, so the LTCM 3 and LTCM 3.2? Basically, the information that we are able to receive. In that case, for example, if you are to work with BeiDou and Galileo, you must use the LTCM 3.2, that is the most updated format. Okay, a request also from different languages of the webinar. We will check also with our dealer. Did you compare the GPS plus GLONASS performance with the GPS GLONASS BeiDou plus Galileo under the three or urban canyons? Not directly from my side, but we have some customers, also some dealers that already checked it, already compared it. Usually, if you work with the GPS BeiDou and Galileo, you will receive also a better accuracy of the data, so in elevation, but also in horizontal. Yes, this is improve using this kind of format. So using also the Galileo and BeiDou constellation, you can improve also the accuracy. the speed depends on the receiver, but generally yes, because you receive also more satellites. What is the benefit having more channels? Usually, if you have more channels, you are also able to receive more satellite. But of course, it depends on the hardware used. When the coverage of Hexagon will also include the Eastern Europe countries, we need to check with our partners or with the Hexagon support for the network. Extra safe mode, yes, is only for Zenit 35 Pro. But of course, if you have some other question, please feel free to write us, not only here in the chat, but also to our email. We will provide you also all the data that you need. What is the total number of satellite tracked you have ever got with the Zenit GNSS? Last year I were in Asia Pacific, I was able to track more or less 48 satellites. One satellite to occupy how many channels? We already seen more or less. So here for the currency. So if you consider, for example, in that case, the Zenit 40, which is equipped with the 555 channels, it means that, for example, considering three frequencies, so not only L1, L2, but also L3, but it depends on the constellation, one satellite means three channels, so three frequencies. If we divide 555 for three channels, means that we can track at the same time 185 satellites. So in general, we have more channels that we really need. In general, also the GNSS are equipped with also more channels than you will see in the specification. What is the minimum of satellites required for RTK connection? It depends also on the software, but basically should be 4 GPS satellites. Okay, more or less we covered all the questions. We had some questions from our dealer. So thank you for the participation. Just to remind you, on our website, we have also some other webinars dedicated and directly open to everyone, dedicated also to some other topics. If you have some other question, please write us directly on our email. We will reply you also with some data in case you need it. Thanks to everybody.